Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Rizwan Virk here. Riz is the founder of the startup accelerator Playlabs at MIT. He's also the author of a new book called Startup Myths and Models, What You Won't Learn in Business School. And we're going to talk about video games, startups, and so much more. So stay tuned, and we'll be back right after this message.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Rizwan Virk, who is the author of Startup Myths and Models, What You Won't Learn in Business School. He's a successful entrepreneur, video game pioneer, and venture capitalist. He's also the founder of the startup accelerator Playlabs at MIT. He's a graduate of MIT and Stanford, and also the author of Zen Entrepreneurship, Walking the Path of the Career Warrior, Treasure Hunt, Follow Your Inner Clues to Find True Success, and the Simulation Hypothesis, an MIT computer scientist, shows us why AI, quantum physics, and Eastern mystics all agree we are all in a video game. That's a great title, by the way. It's so nice to have you here, Riz.
Thanks for having me on.
Well, I got a... first of all, you're welcome, and I had a very Matrix vibe from that last title, but I'm really kind of fascinated by everything you do, first of all. I was watching a video you made about the accelerator Playlabs at MIT, and I kind of want to start there. I do want to get into your book for sure, but how did you, give me a little backstory to, obviously I mentioned you graduated from MIT and Stanford. So give me your backstory and how you got to the Playlabs.
Sure. So, you know, I started off as an entrepreneur, fresh out of MIT. And, you know, I kind of had the impression that what I call the overarching myth of startups, which is that you come up with an idea, you pitch it to some investors, they like it, you build a product, customers adopt it, everything goes well, and then the company goes public and everyone's, fat, rich, and happy.
Right.
Straight line. And, you know, one of my favorite graphs is to show, you know, that's sort of what people think success is like, but the reality is that it tends to have lots of twists and turns along the way. So it's rarely a straight line. And so, you know, as an entrepreneur, you know, I ran into many challenges in my companies initially. After initial, you know, amount of success, we'd raise venture capital financing, and then we'd run into all kinds of different problems. And so I started to think about, you know, what are some of the lessons that I learned there. And then, you know, later when I became a video game entrepreneur, we had the number one grossing game in the iTunes App Store back in 2010. Now it's a game called Tap Fish, which is, I guess, 10 years ago now. So it was mobile gaming is no longer a new industry, but I started to notice that, you know, these startup markets, particularly within video games, you know, they went through waves. And then I became an investor in a number of different video game startups, some of which your listeners may have heard of, like Telltale Games, which has a Game of Thrones and a Walking Dead game that are pretty well known, and Discord, which is a very popular chat app that's used. Mm-hmm. And in fact, if your listeners don't use it, their kids probably do.
Yeah.
It's used by a lot of gamers. And then I started to, you know, get involved with virtual reality and augmented reality a number of years ago. And, you know, that kind of led me to want to have a forum where I could teach some of these lessons to groups of entrepreneurs at once rather than, you know, going one by one. And so it was around the time I sold my last game company that the MIT Game Lab asked me to come and do something there. And, you know, when I was a student at MIT, they didn't really teach us any video game classes, but now they have a whole lab dedicated to building video games because it's a pretty popular area.
That would be so much
so
fun.
So I went back and started this accelerator for playful technology companies, which are using video game technology, which could be virtual reality, augmented reality, 3D modeling, or even digital currency like blockchain, and really in any industry. And so it was a summer-based accelerator that we ran for a few years. I'm taking a break from it now to focus on my writing, but we may start it up again soon.
It's really interesting, and I know one-tenth of what you forgot last week when it comes to software creation, but I have interviewed Richard Stallman and Jürgen Schmidhuber and a lot of really interesting people on the show, and my son-in-law-to-be has created an app that does something to do with gaming, and I wish I could explain it in depth, but I can't. But I know that there's a lot of companies that are looking to do some of these gaming, you know, tie into it because it's so popular. And yet, I was thinking about when we're talking about AI and virtual reality kind of games, different things that are coming out. I was wondering what happened to virtual reality. I can remember when my kids were, I'm thinking nearly 30 years ago, maybe 25, you know, I took them out and they'd have these really cool simulations of these virtual reality goggles you'd put on, and I can remember shooting at my kids in this store, and I'm thinking, oh, I can't wait till they make this better, and then it kind of just went away. I mean, it's back now, but it's different, and what was that big gap in time, and why didn't it do more?
Well, you know, virtual reality is an interesting technology that has also gone through many different waves, and yeah, there was that first wave probably back in the 90s is what you're talking about.
Yeah.
But, you know, they never really made the technology small enough to be a consumer-based device. And then a second wave kicked off, you know, when Facebook bought Oculus for a couple $1 billion back mm-hmm. in like 2012, I think, or 13, I forget the exact year. And suddenly what happened was a lot of venture capitalists started to invest in VR content companies and on the consumer side. But then, you know, that also kind of had a bit of a peak, and then it went down into a valley. And in Startup Myths, I talk about how startup markets evolve through these different phases. They start off as a nascent industry, it gets super hot, and then it starts to mature. And what happened with VR was that a lot of those bets didn't pay off because a lot of consumers weren't using the headsets very often. In fact, I had a friend at Facebook who said that, you know, whereas with smartphones, someone would use your smartphone like 100 times a day, you know, with VR, people were using it once a week maybe, so the usage patterns weren't quite there. But then in the last year, actually even before this whole pandemic, VR had started to make a little bit of a comeback on the consumer side with the Oculus Quest, which is kind of a standalone headset and that you don't need to plug into a computer, and there are other headsets like that as well. But, you know, one area where VR actually has made an impact has been in training for enterprises. So basically anywhere where they can, you know, dictate, okay, put on the headset because it's much cheaper training you to operate a forklift, for example,
right,
in VR than to have you crash, you know, an actual forklift machine. So
right.
Training and education is one area where it actually has, you know, made an impact over the past few years. And then turns out, you know, like the Oculus Quest headset was sold out. We're still waiting for more. So there's a whole new resurgence now, especially with this pandemic and people staying at home, that virtual reality may be a way to have interactions and conferences, you know, without actually having to travel.
Yeah.
So we're about to see yet another wave, I think, of VR companies.
Well, I'm all up for the holodeck from Star Trek. Is that ever going to happen? Something where you can have a room? It doesn't make any sense because I don't know how you'd have the three dimensions of movement, but or running into a wall. But is there something like that sensation that they're working on?
Well, I think that's the eventual goal of all of this technology. And in
mm-hmm.
fact, you know, you had mentioned sort of the Matrix vibe in my last book,
mm-hmm.
Which was called The Simulation Hypothesis.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, part of the reason I wrote that book was a few years ago I was playing virtual reality ping pong. And, you know, as I was playing it, it was so realistic, the responses. It felt like I was really hitting a ball.
Hmm.
That at the end of the game, I decided to put the paddle down on the table. And of course, there is no table.
Yeah.
It's virtual reality. And then I leaned on the table and I almost fell over. And that's when I realized, oh, wow, the actual responsiveness of the technologies are getting to the point where we might be able to fool ourselves into not being able to distinguish between the virtual world and the physical world, and that really ties to something like the Matrix, where, if you remember in the movie, they had when Neo, Keanu Reeves' character, woke up, he had the wire into the back of his head, and that's right. How they beamed the actual game. And so I thought about what are the different stages of technology that we would have to go through to get there, and included brain-computer interfaces, which is, you know, sending information directly to the brain and pulling information out. And so, you know, I estimate we're about 100 years away, you know, around, give or take, in order to be able to build something like the Matrix. So maybe not quite the holodeck, although, you know, holographs are also proceeding quite a bit in terms of technology. There's a field called light field display, and the idea is that if you measure the light going off, say, a cup to your eyes versus the eyes of somebody across the room, and you know exactly how the light bounces off the cup, these holograms can try to reproduce it. And so now we're starting to blur the distinction between what is a physical object and what is a digital object, right? So it's very possible we'll have something like the holodeck. They even, some Japanese researchers found recently that they could give you tactile sensations by using a little bit of radiation in the gloves, so it'll feel like you're actually touching.
I don't know if I like that, but...
Yeah, I mean, it was a small amount.
A little bit like CAT scan, little bit, or?
No, very little, much less than that.
Okay.
By using some electrical stimulus. And so The idea is, if we can simulate the light, how it bounces off an object, if eventually we can give you what the tactile sensation feels like, then we could see something like the holodeck at some point, you know, in the future. But we're still a ways off from that, I think.
You know, it's so interesting because my next book's on perception, and I write about curiosity, and all these things ties into all the stuff I'm interested in researching. And as you were talking about inserting tech directly into the brain, I love the idea of the Matrix just being able to get knowledge so fast. But then again, how much of it is, if we do that, is like dropping you at the top of the mountain instead of having you hike up and having the experience. So do you get the same feeling when you get it all just given to you rather than working for it sometimes? And I'm going to be curious to see where that all leads. But I love the idea of just instantaneous learning. Go ahead.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I was going to say, you know, that's an interesting area, you know, downloading information into the brain. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it also touches on a lot of philosophical areas like false memories, you know.
Right, right.
Things that were in the science fiction works.
Schwarzenegger.
Total Recall.
Total Recall, right.
You know, I actually interviewed Philip K. Dick's wife.
Oh, you did?
Part of writing the simulation hypothesis, you know. And, you know, he felt that we really were in a computer-generated reality, like the Matrix.
Uh-huh.
It was kind of a fun... I think it's more likely than not, and, you know, I lay out a bunch of reasons why I think that the physical world around us is not necessarily the real world. It's just, we're getting impulses into our brain, which are showing us certain things. And so I go through different weirdness in quantum physics. I look at the technology and the software side, and then also, if you look at the world's religions, right, pretty much all along they've been telling us that the physical world around us isn't the real world. And science has kind of said, well, that's not true, but now we're getting to the point where we can't find this thing called matter. It gets back to this idea of this distinction between what is data and what is a physical object, right? If you open up if you look at a table and you look at the molecules and you look at the atoms, and you're talking mostly empty space. It turns out physicists, when they get to the bottom level, they can't find the thing called matter. All they find is information. They find properties of it. And that's really all you can say with any definitiveness at that level. So in the end, it could be that these are all just pixels of information that are being rendered for us in our brain.
We maybe are the brains in the jar from Star Trek reference again. You know, it reminds me of Sixth Day, with Schwarzenegger again, where he's got the virtual girl sitting on his lap. He says, if all your senses tell you it's a hot girl sitting on your lap, then what difference does it make sometimes? And I think that it's going to get to the point where, if you analyze it, do you really want to know that you're in the Matrix? I don't think I'd want to know.
Right. Well, that was the idea of the blue pill and the red pill.
Right.
The Matrix, right?
Which one was when you found out? I don't think I'd take that.
You take the red pill, I think, and you wake up. And you take the blue pill and you wake up in your bed the next day.
Okay.
And there was even a character in the movie who, after he had woken up, decided he didn't want to be there anymore. Right,
right.
They were going to put him back in the Matrix and have him forget
right.
all about it. because that he would have preferred that.
Right? Uh-huh.
So I personally would prefer to know if we're inside a video game, you know, what video games have quests and achievements and ways that we level up.
Yeah, I'd like that too. I think if it's good and you could do something about it, then I'd like to know. If you're stuck in that sloppy water, whatever it was they had to live in, I don't know if I'd like that as well, but it is interesting.
Well, <yeah.
laughs> It is interesting to look at all of the AI, all the artificial intelligence, virtual reality and different things that companies are working with. And your latest book, you write about some of these startups and the things that they have to do and what they have and haven't learned to succeed. And having been the former MBA program chair at the Forbes School of Business, I know what they learn in business school. So I'm really interested to know in your book what they're going to learn that they wouldn't have learned in business school.
Sure. Well, you know, I went to Stanford Business School a number of years ago, and I found that, you know, a lot of what we learned was tailored towards companies that have some kind of cash flow already.
Right.
Right. You learn about discounted cash flows. You learn how to make projections. And I remember, you know, in one case, the professor had literally written the textbook on decision modeling. It was a textbook about how to do complex spreadsheets.
Uh-huh.
And we went through this entire, you know, long set of spreadsheets.
Uh-huh.
You have on the right hand side, you have, you know, value 1, 2, and 3, and you look at them and say, oh, this one is better, and that's how we make decisions. And I remember raising my hand and I said, well, what if you change the value all the way on the left? And he says, well, then you get a different set of outcomes. And I said, well, but how do you know what numbers to plug in? And he said, well, in some cases you have to look at history. The problem with startups is that the past doesn't equal the future, right? And so we don't know what numbers to put in into those spreadsheets. And so then the second part is you have to rely on your gut a bit, which is what entrepreneurs often have to do. But so I felt that a lot of what we learned in business school, was interesting, but it applied to either the financial markets, you know, becoming, managing money, or it applied to becoming a manager in a big company where you could actually try to reduce things to a science. And so this book is about some of the things that happen in the startup world where not only does the past not equal the future, but a lot of times entrepreneurs are making decisions thinking that the present is going to equal the future. So if you're in a really hot market, like we were in mobile games back in 2010, it was a relatively easy market to get into. You could spend 25 cents per user. There weren't that many games. Today there's over 1 million games in the App Store. So the market has changed. So I know guys who sold their companies back then, like we did. We sold to a big Japanese company, and guys that held on, and some of those guys that held on weren't very happy because today it's a much more difficult market. You end up paying several dollars per user, and you have to spend millions of dollars to get users for your mobile game, whereas back then, you know, we spent $25,000. And so not only does the past not equal the future, but the present doesn't equal the future. And so, you know, these assumptions are kind of built into the way we make decisions. And so I wrote the book as a series of myths and new models that could apply to startup markets. You know, I used to like the supply and demand curves that economists would draw, and they'd say, you know, this is how the market evolves, this is how things change. When prices change, we find an equilibrium.
Right.
The problem was, again, there weren't any good models for the startup world, and so that's what led me to writing this book.
Well, you bring up some really important points, and actually my work in curiosity found that there's four things that keep people from being curious, and you mentioned one of them, assumptions. And that's a big factor in what people do. That's what leads to status quo thinking. So I love this. And you talk about the startup model, which you just mentioned. I want to talk about that. What is a startup model that you're talking about?
Well, so the book goes through a few different models, but one in particular, I call it the startup market life cycle.
Okay.
So it shows, you know, how a new market evolves from literally garage inventors to a multi-billion dollar industry with multiple multi-billion dollar companies. And, you know, I found the model myself applying in enterprise software with the internet and then with mobile games. And it was after the last recession in 2008 when Apple introduced the App Store that allowed third-party developers to make apps, that I really, you know, saw this model happening, because it was a repeat of what I had seen in other markets. And, you know, some of this tends to be true even if you go as far back as like automobiles. You know, I grew up in Detroit, and I used to always wonder, why are there all these, you know, makes and models like Oldsmobile and Buick? Well, it turns out they were all, you know, entrepreneurs, garage entrepreneurs,
right.
who created these car companies that then got acquired. And so back then, you could create a car company in a garage. Today, if you try to create a car company in a garage, maybe if you're Elon Musk, you can spend $180 million of your own money plus another $300 million of Department of Energy money, you could start a car company, but you can't really do it the way it was done back then. And so that's the reality of a mature market. It costs much more to get into that market. And so I lay out these stages of the market, and the nascent stage is when they're hobbyists who are playing around with the technology.
Right.
And then that goes into what I call the growing phase, and that's when a lot of venture capitalists start to invest in a market, because everybody starts to say, hey, this is the next big market, and they put money in. Then there's this kind of very unique thing that happens in the tech space, which I call a super hot market, where things just go crazy, and valuations go through the roof for a period of time. You know, it happened in the dot-com days, it happened in the mobile game industry, it happened in many different industries, but it only lasts a short period of time. Then what happens is the market starts to mature. Now, during the super hot phase, everybody and their mother jumps in, right? Back in the 90s, everyone was like, hey, I have an idea for a website. A few years ago, I remember everyone was coming to me saying, hey, I have an idea for an app, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
It was the same kind of thing, but when the market starts to mature, a lot of those guys who started companies, they don't succeed, even if they got some angel funding, and those companies start to go out of business, and things start to consolidate. Now, what happens is that you can tell which phase of the market you're in by looking at multiples of revenue, for example. Mm-hmm. So again, in business school, everything was about multiples of cash flow. But remember, in startup world, nobody has cash flow until they're already a successful company. And so you can look at multiples of revenue, and 3 to 5 times revenues is a pretty typical multiple for what the growing phase. In the nascent phase, there really aren't any multiples. Nobody's really acquiring anyone, or if they do,
right.
they acquire the company just for an acquihire. During the super hot phase, you could have multiples at 10 times revenues. Back in mobile gaming, there was a company called NG Moco, which sold for $400 million to a Japanese company. And their revenue was around $30 million, so it was a 10x. There was another company that sold to Gree for $100 million that had less than $1 million in revenue. So you're talking about 100x multiples, right? Because in that stage, it's more of strategic buys, and there's not really a lot of rationality going on. But then, when the market starts to mature, as started to happen in mobile gaming in 2012, 2013, you start to recognize there are leaders, it's hard to become a leader, and the cost is more expensive. So there was a company that Gree, a Japanese public company, bought called Funzio in 2012 for $200 million. Now that seems like a lot of money, mm-hmm. but their revenue was already $50 million, so it was only a 4x multiple on revenues at that point. And just recently, a company that I had invested in that had a Star Trek game that did very well over time, they ended up selling that game for 1x revenues, right? Because it wasn't based on revenue, it was based on cash flow. Now, mobile gaming is like a $30 billion plus market. It's the biggest component of the mature video game market, which is a $100 billion market, is even bigger than Hollywood in terms of, you know, total revenues. And there are multiple public companies. So I saw it grow from just, you know, a couple of guys in a garage. We built our first game for $25,000 to, you know, you have Fortnite and Pokemon Go, and not many people know this, but Pokemon Go, the company that made them, had raised $30 million, you know, before they released that game. So to build a game today and to be successful, you need way more money, just like if you wanted to start an auto company. And so that's one of the models that I go through in the book, is how these markets evolve and how multiples go up and then they go down. Now, overall valuations go up. If you were to add up all the valuations in the market today of mobile game companies, it's way more than what it was back in 2010, 2011, 2012. And also, if you add up the market size, it's $30 billion, as I said, way more than it was back then. So while valuations and market size are going up, it's much harder for an entrepreneur who's operating with very limited resources to really get in there and attack that market.
Well, as you bring up resources and raising money, I mean, it's challenging to do this financing. You're talking about how much money is required, and I mean, forgive me for not giving gaming examples, but just startup examples, just because I think a lot of people might be able to relate to them more in case they don't do gaming. But how do you know, as if your company, I mean, how long does it take to become a TikTok, or how long does it take to raise the money to get to the level where you reach that level of success? And if you're investing in something like that, if you want to help, you know, raise funds for that, how do you know you're not getting into a Theranos?
Well, so those are complicated questions, right?
Right.
It's as much as we'd like to say this is a science that can be taught, there is an art to it as well. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, a lot of what the book is about is mm-hmm. that there are these pieces of advice, mm-hmm. for example, that people give out. You know, in raising money. Like, one of them is talk to as many investors as you can, right? You may have to talk to 40, 50 investors to find an investor that might fit your startup. But, you know, the reason I call it a myth is there's a kernel of truth to it, but you also have to understand, you know, under which conditions it's true and which conditions it's not. Turns out, a lot of times, your first investors are people that you either have a relationship with already or that they are already wanting to invest in the market that you are in, right? And so what's important is not to talk to 100 different investors, but it's to find the investors that are more likely to invest in you and to really kind of narrow down what you're looking for. There was an entrepreneur named Gary Sanga who started a legal tech company called Intelligize a few years ago. And, you know, he went to University of Pennsylvania and he was a lawyer. He didn't have a lot of contacts the VC world. Turns out his first investors was a venture capitalist who was also an alumnus of University of Pennsylvania, right? Same thing, you know, in my case, I had graduated from MIT. And so, you know, he says, what's your tribe? And right. If you can find investors that are in that tribe, mm-hmm. then you're much more likely to be able to get the initial investment. Now, in terms of how long it takes, well, that could vary, right? I mean, there's different rounds. There's sort of what's called a pre-seed round now, which is really, you know, could be a small amount of money from friends and family,
right.
Anywhere from $25,000 to $500,000. That used to be called a seed round, but now a seed round tends to be, you know, several hundred thousand up to maybe 1 or 2 million in Silicon Valley.
And that's before you get to Series A and all that, right?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Then you get to Series A, and usually by Series A, you need to have a product that's been released and show some kind of traction of that product in the marketplace. And some seed investors now are starting to say that as well. They don't want to invest in a company that has a product that's still being developed. They want to see some amount of traction in the marketplace. I mean, startups have a high failure rate, and so that's where investors are constantly looking at ways, how do we reduce risk and still generate a good return down the road?
Well, you know, I've seen some of these companies that have done very well, but they keep getting more series funding. They go way past B, C, D. They just keep going, and they eventually want to go IPO, but then they just go to another series. Is there too far to go? Is there a point where you really need to sell out? You need to go IPO, do something?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, part of the reason why I came up with this model that I described earlier is for entrepreneurs to make a decision about when to sell the company, mm-hmm. as well.
Right, right.
I mean, most successful tech companies get sold, right? Of course, you know, people in the general public don't know that because they know of Google and Facebook and Twitter, right? These are public companies, but it's probably 0.1%, right?
Right, right.
So a tenth of a percent of companies that make it to that stage, whereas most of the other companies that are successful, let's say 90% fail, 10% or 9.9% are successful by being acquired by bigger tech companies like a Microsoft or a Google. And then the 0.1% might actually go public. And so what started to happen, though, with the, if you remember in the dot-com days, everyone was going public, right?
Right, right.
Going, without any revenues. That ended up being problematic, led to the crash.
A bit.
The crash of 2008, though, is when it actually became really hard uh-huh. for companies to go public. And so what started to happen was companies that were already successful, instead of going IPO, they were holding out as long as possible. And this is true even of Facebook and Google. In fact, I think Facebook ended up having to go public because they had over 500 shareholders, right? And so the SEC didn't give them a choice. They consider you public at a certain point if you have too many shareholders. What was happening was that a lot of the early employees were selling shares of Facebook to other people, and so that was increasing. Even though it was still a private company, it was a successful company that everybody knew about, so other people wanted to get in. I even bought some shares myself back in 2008 through a private sale. But at that point, you know, there became too many shareholders for it to go public. But it's really since then that this phenomenon of unicorns, which are
right.
companies valued at $1 billion that are still private, incidentally, it was a term defined by Aileen Lee, who was actually a classmate of mine at MIT many years ago.
Uh-huh.
Little known trivia fact, I actually
cool.
lost to her in the election for class president.
Well,
know,
hey,
from a long time ago.
that's somebody who really, I guess you can say you don't mind losing to, right?
Right, exactly.
Uh-huh.
Yep, absolutely. But so companies, you know, are doing these later series. And, you know, I've been telling entrepreneurs a good way to actually cash out is to sell some of your stock in a Series C or Series D. So there's a whole new market for things called secondary sales, a private secondary sales, which is you don't sell the company, you don't go public, but you're still able to sell some of your shares because you have investors that are wanting to get in the company, and the company has real revenue or has a number of users. Now, one of my investments that's gotten to that stage that I talked about or I mentioned earlier was Discord, which many people know Slack in
right.
the business world, but Discord is kind of like the chat in the gaming world.
Mm-hmm.
They have something like 40 million users now, and they're a unicorn that's been publicly announced because they've done a series, I don't even know what series we're at now, D or E at this point.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's when a company gets to that point that, you know, some of the early employees are able to sell their shares and to cash out a bit, or some of the early investors as well. And so, you know, they may go public someday, they may not, I don't know. But yeah, that's kind of the trend nowadays, is that there are only so many companies that are successful that there are all these investors that want to get in. And I talked about reducing risk earlier. So one of the ways to reduce risk is to go invest in companies that are already successful.
Right.
Of course, that means you're going to be investing at $1 billion valuation or more, depending on how successful they are, right?
Mm-hmm.
Series C, D, or E. You know, whereas myself as an investor, I tend to invest in the very early days of startups, and those tend to be very risky and have a much higher failure rate.
Well, you bring up so many things that I hope you don't mind if I keep you a little longer, because I got a couple questions for you.
Sure, absolutely.
Okay, so as you talk about the secondary sales, you know, when you're selling your shares, how do you find the people to sell to at that point? Are you selling to the same people who originally bought in, and what message does it send if the creator of the company starts to sell shares?
If the creator or the founders or the CEO
mm-hmm.
is selling a lot of their shares,
mm-hmm.
then that's a bad signal, right?
Mm-hmm. So, right, right.
It means maybe they don't have confidence that the value of the shares are going to go up. But typically, founders can't sell all their shares anyway, so that's not really a concern. And the investors usually put stipulations on, you know, what you can sell. So usually you're selling a very small percentage of
mm-hmm.
your shares. You know, if you sell 10% or less, you still own 90%. It's a way of getting rewarded for having built a successful company, you know, without actually having sold it, but it gives you the opportunity to keep building it. So some investors might see it as a positive at that stage. Now, if you're at that very early stage and you're selling your company and you have no revenue or no users, okay, then something's really wrong, right?
Yeah, that, right.
That's negative signaling to investors that this company, you don't believe that it's going to go up. But at that stage, you know, once you've been building it up and you have $100 million in revenue, there's no reason that you should be able to sell a smaller percentage. Now, in terms of who you sell the shares to, typically there are these late-stage funds who are looking for Series C, D, or E type of investments, and they're growth funds typically. And, you know, they're looking for returns of 2 to 3X, right? Whereas if somebody who invests in the seed stage is hoping they might get 10 to 100 times their money back if the company is successful. But at that late stage, it's typically funds who are looking for a more modest return but very little risk. They want all their investments to be successful at that point.
Well, okay, so if you bought in, you said you like to invest early, and if you do that and they have more and more shares that they're offering, are you getting diluted at all? Is there, explain that process.
Sure. So, you know, with each series, starting with a seed or series A
mm-hmm.
or series B, what happens is that the investors buy additional shares in the company, and they have typically a percentage that they're trying to get. Mm-hmm. So you might start off with the founders owning, let's say there's two founders owning 100% of the company. Then you could have a VC come in and say, I'll give you $1 million for a third of the company. So what happens is they put in $1 million and they get the third, let's say 20% of the company to make the math easier.
Okay? Right.
Now, we have what's called a pre-money and a post-money valuation. So in that case, the pre-money is $4 million and the post-money is $5 million. Now, why is it $5 million? Because they bought $1 million worth of shares and they own 20% of the company. So $1 million is 20% of $5 million. And so that's the post-money valuation in that round. So what that means is the original founders got diluted by 20%, but they didn't lose their shares. Their shares are still their shares. It's just that there are now more shares out there.
Right.
And to make the math easy, you might say there were 4 million shares beforehand. Now there's 5 million shares. So the new investors bought 1 million shares at $1 each, and that's what got the post-money valuation of $5 million.
So how do the original investors feel about them keep adding in more and more shares? Do they have any say?
So usually what happens is that some investors, like venture capitalists, they have veto rights, you know, over a new round. But of course, in the early days, you want the company to keep growing, and so if the company needs money, then you have to sell more shares to raise money. That's why there's not just a Series A, there's a Series B and a Series C, is that the company may need
more
money.
How many series have
operating.
You seen the most people go to? What's the highest?
I think E or F is probably the highest that I've seen. Usually at that point, the company should either be going public or it's what's called a recap. A recap is, you know, recapitalization of the company, which means things didn't go so well, right? So if it went well, then maybe the company's on the way to going public. If it's a recap, it means, okay, the company didn't do so well, it's out of money, and then you might start at Series AA, right? You might say, okay, new investors will put in money, but everybody gets diluted way down. That's not something you want. That's called a down round. And then when that happens, that's when the dilution is a real concern, because then your shares go down dramatically, your percentage. Just raising money at a 20% dilution is not a big concern, because it means the company has more money to keep going. And you still own the same shares you had, and your percentage is a little bit less.
You know, I'm thinking of a company that went through a lot of series funding, and the CEO was really hoping to get unicorn status and turned down offers. And, you know, so a lot of the people are staying as employees because they have all these shares. They keep thinking it's eventually going to sell. Do you see that happen where, the ego gets in there and they just don't want to take offers?
Oh yeah, that happens often. So in startup myths and models, the way I organize it is based on a series of myths and the stages of the hero's journey. And you know, if you go to Joseph Campbell's stages, and I adapt them to startups, which is the call to adventure, equipping yourself for the journey, travel companions, the road of trials, which is about going to market, and then acquiring the treasure, which is myths about selling your company, and then finally a trip to the underworld and the return. But in acquiring the treasure, you know, one of the myths is that at this rate, my startup will be worth twice as much tomorrow, right?
Right.
And so it's a common myth, and it happens all the time. And it happened, you know, back in the 90s. I remember people turning down offers for $100 million that really regretted it later on down the road, because then the company ended up being worthless. And so, in fact, that happens often, and it's happened in companies that I've invested in, companies that were on their way to being quite successful. I'll even give you an example. Telltale Games, I mentioned earlier, you know, they had a Walking Dead game that did over $100 million in revenue. Its products were loved in the industry, and everyone thought this is going to be the next big unicorn, and the valuation got up to, like, I don't remember now, it was like $300 million, I think, somewhere in that range. And then they had a hiccup, and they ran out of money, and then the whole thing basically crashed, right? And so here's a company that everybody thought was going to be successful. In fact, was successful in the marketplace, right? If you look at its products and even revenue, but they ran into cash flow problems. I mean, we won't get into the specifics of what happened to cause that, but and then, you know, all the investors and all the employees basically ended up not making any money. From that, which was really unfortunate, especially since it was such a beloved set of games that people like to play out there.
So what keeps the competitor from basically copying that idea and taking it to the next level, kind of the Facebook after MySpace kind of, I've learned what you've done right and wrong and made
right,
it better.
And that happens often. I mean, one of the early myths in stage one, the call to adventure, is you have to be first to market, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's a common myth that people think.
Right.
But the reality, at least in the tech world, is it's often the second or third mover who is successful that ends up defining the market. It's rarely the very first people. I mean, if you look at going all the way back now to spreadsheets, right? The first spreadsheet was VisiCalc. And one of my professors at Stanford was an investor in VisiCalc. And they thought this thing was going to be the next big thing. And then, of course, it was Lotus 1-2-3 with its spreadsheet, and then eventually Microsoft Excel that really became the big winners in that marketplace.
Right.
Whereas the product that was the initial success ended up not being the one down the road. And it's like the old saying that the pioneers are the ones who get the arrows in the back.
Right.
Because, they discovered the market, but others can quickly see. But there is a point at which, like, if you were to try to go after Facebook now, it's very difficult to do. So the market has matured. And so there's a point at which, and one of the curves I talked about, in business school we learned about supply-demand curves.
Right.
In my book, I have the multiples curve, which I talked about earlier, which goes up and down. Then there's the valuations curve. There's the capital required curve. But there's also the startup opportunity curve. So the best time to get into a market may actually be around that time when it's growing. It's not too early. It's not too late. Everybody's not in yet. It's not super hot yet. Because you can get in there and you can be what's called a fast follower. Right? Mm-hmm. And that fast follower knows there's a market. They're able to get in. And assuming that they're able to execute, it really comes down to execution risk at that point, not necessarily market risk.
Is it, what's trending now? I mean, are we going to forever have Candy Crush? Is it going to be gambling? Is it going to be sports? Is it, blow them up? What's the thing right now?
What do you mean in games?
Yeah.
Games go through different cycles. I mean, what's happened now is because of the virus, a lot of people are staying home more, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's actually one industry that hasn't been too affected, in terms of total revenues, because, in fact, people are probably playing games more now than they were before. Now, one of the things that happened in the mobile gaming revolution, which I was a part of, was that there were a lot more casual players of games, right? Before that, it was like you had to have a console and you were playing on your Xbox. But, you have Candy Crush and you had all these casual games.
Mm-hmm.
Recently the big game for the past few years has been Fortnite.
Right.
Right. And what you're starting to see there is that it's transitioning into a strange kind of virtual world, right? And Minecraft, right? So those are some of the big ones more recently. But there's this idea of creating these virtual worlds. And this idea has been around for a while. If you remember Second Life back in 2007.
Right.
Was one of the first ones, but it was only on the laptop.
That's the one where you bought clothes and things offline, kind of paid for outfits and things. They had their own sales. Was that Second Life? I can't remember.
Second Life was a virtual world where you had your avatar and you would interact with other people. It's kind of like The Sims, but it was
online. But I think you could actually purchase like clothing and outfit and cars and things that for the within the game as a
That's right. You would spend real money
for nothing
to buy this, and people were actually buying not just outfits, but all kinds of things, and land as well.
Yeah.
In the virtual world, and so it led to the beginnings of a virtual economy. Even though Second Life is not really very popular anymore, Fortnite had the largest concert, right, in the world, which had, I forget how many millions of people were attending this concert, but they were attending it in world. And so I think, there's this blending of the virtual world and the physical world that's starting to come about. And actually the recent, social distancing and working at home and remotely is just adding to that idea that we'll have more and more virtual interactions with people. And so I think that will make its way into games. But also gamification, is making its way into non-game
world. Right,
right. I see emails that say, you've opened 4 of 10 emails this week, which is a technique that we use
That's great.
In gaming in order to get people to complete the collection. you have to do this so many times.
Well, I love that example. And, you know, I'm trying to get companies to work on developing curiosity, and if it takes gamification or whatever it takes. But I'm trying, as you're talking about all these things, I'm wondering how you can combine gaming or gamification of things in the working world to get people more curious to create something productive and not just go down a Candy Crush hole.
Right. I mean, you absolutely can. I mean, there's a whole area called serious games, mm-hmm. serious gaming, which is about using either games themselves or gaming techniques to apply to other areas. You know, we talked about virtual reality. You know, I'm an investor in a company called Verzoom, which is a bike riding or fitness application, but you put on the virtual reality headset, so it feels
kind
like
of Peloton-ish,
bike.
But virtual reality
yeah.
headset.
Yeah, so using VR, and you can mm-hmm. actually meet people inside that game.
Uh-huh.
Others companies have done, you know, where they've helped with phobias, you know, using virtual reality, etc. But you know, more often you can use similar techniques within games. To get people to do certain things, whether it's running contests or to have certain incentives, right? I mean, that's really what it comes down to is, you know, do you have an incentive to work with other people? Do you have an incentive to compete? Are you trying to get to be at the leaderboard? So you kind of look at, you know, social competitiveness as a way, is one way that gamification has been used. You know, I remember, you know, examples of like hotels that were, you know, they would put 60% of the people or 90% of the people, you know, in this room, put their towels down the floor, they need to be cleaned or something, you know,
mm-hmm.
but using some type of social proof. I mean, you're kind of using gamification techniques. And so I think a lot of those can be applied, you know, within the corporate world as well, particularly around incentives and ways to get people to work together and to do simulations, whether they're virtual or not.
Can you think of big companies who are doing things that people know off the top of your head that do this serious gaming to get people to game to create products?
Well, I mean, off the top of my head, I'm thinking more of using virtual reality for training and education purposes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so for training and education, it ends up being quite useful, right?
Right.
Because you're I mentioned the forklift example, but it goes beyond that, which is also just, you know, teaching people how to do certain tasks, you know, by putting on a VR headset, you can kind of go through and simulate that. One of the companies we had at Playlabs at MIT is a company called Wanda VR, and they let you use 360 video. So I don't know if you know what that is, but it's like video that, like on your phone, you can kind of move the phone around and you can see a 360 panorama
uh-huh.
of the whole thing. And so they were able to, they use that to build training, and it's used, you know, for everything from like training ticket takers at a stadium, right?
Right.
On what to do to other types of scenarios within big companies, big tech companies. And so,
right.
So I'm thinking, you know, that's an area that maybe I've been more exposed to, but I'm sure there are other gamification techniques that I'm not so involved with, but that are out there.
Yeah, as a pharmaceutical rep, I worked for AstraZeneca for a long time, and we did a lot of pretend sales presentations. I could see a lot of that would be great for that, interacting without actually having to be in front of the doctor or what, you know, giving your presentation in that particular way. There's so many things I could see being helpful for, but your book was really fascinating to me. All your work has been really fascinating to me because I think you have this really great insight on some of the things that I wish that we taught more in the business schools. And, you know, a lot of it that we don't taught and we don't teach are soft skills in general. And I think there's a lot that can be added to our education, and hopefully we can either learn it through technology or some other way and add even more to what we help people learn. And you help entrepreneurs handle stress. You help startups knowing when it's the right time and all these things in your book. And I think if people are listening to this and they're trying to decide if this is the book for them, what's the main message? Who's your main person you'd like to read this? What would you like to say to them?
Well, I mean, I'd like to say that, you know, doing your own company is really like an adventure, right?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, like the classical adventures, you're going to have ups and downs. And so this book is a way to help navigate, you know, those obstacles. And, you know, anybody who's been an entrepreneur knows that it's not just all roses, that there are real challenges that come up, and sometimes we need advice to help us. And so, you know, I view this book as my way of being able to be there for a larger number of people who are embarking on this adventure, where they can just pull down the book and go to that particular stage that they're in, and hopefully there'll be some food for thought or some mental models on how to think about making decisions, which is sometimes the hardest thing to do on that journey.
And if they want to invest and they've exhausted their friends, spouses, coworkers, tribe, whatever, you know, where do they go from there?
For investors?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, that's where, you know, there are angel investors out there. Mm-hmm. On Angel List is a good site. There's a lot of seed venture capital funds. There's a lot of accelerators now. We mentioned my accelerator at MIT. That was specifically around gaming, but turns out there's accelerators now pretty much in every city. I mean, I grew up in Detroit. Turns out there's at least 3 or 4 startup accelerators in Detroit. And so what many of these accelerators do is they'll invest a small amount of money, but really to help you get your business together and business plan together for the next stage. There's accelerators for food companies, right? There's
who pays
agricultural
for that?
Accelerators. What's that?
Who pays for these accelerators? How is it funded?
It could be individual investors. It could be sometimes you have big companies like Merck or Comcast, mm-hmm, that are paying for an accelerator. There's a group called Techstars that has accelerators in many different cities. So it just really depends.
Mm-hmm.
Now there are many universities that, you know, are starting their own accelerators as well.
ASU does a lot with research out here, I think. And I think it's really interesting to see what's available to entrepreneurs. And I know I kept you way past what we had thought we would be chatting, and I really appreciate you sharing so much insight. I know you have the site zenentrepreneur.com. Is there any other way that people can reach you or anything you'd like to share?
Sure. So, if they go to the site zenentrepreneur.com, they can also download some free chapters or what I call bonus myths, myths that didn't make it into this book, but I thought were important as well, and that can give them a flavor for the book as well. They can contact me on the website. They can also follow me on Twitter, at RizStanford.
Well, that's awesome, Riz. Thank you so much for being on the show. This was so fascinating. I have a million more questions, but I guess I'll have to have that for the next time. So thank you.
Sounds great. Thanks for having me on.
Oh, you're welcome. And we'll be back right after this message. Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate. Well, I'd really like to thank Riz for being my guest today. We get so many interesting people on this show. And I mean, it's just fascinating the depth and just the breadth of everything we talk about. If you've missed any past episodes, they're all at drdianehamilton.com. You can listen to them on the site. You can listen to them, of course, on the radio and podcast stations. But we also transcribe them on the site, which is kind of nice because we link to everything, like Riz's book and anything we talked about. If there's a link to it, you'll find it there. We also have tweetable moments. If you'd like to share something you've read on the site, would love to have you share some of those tweetable moments. And there's a lot of information if you go to curiositycode.com or just the curiosity section on drdianehamilton.com. If you're trying to find out more about cracking the Curiosity Code book or the Curiosity Code Index, you can take the index right there on the site. You'll get your results in about 10 minutes, as long as it takes you to take the assessment. It's very quick. But a lot of companies are utilizing this to train their organizations to become more curious. So I'm training consultants to become certified. They get 5 hours of recertification, SHRM recertification credit. And so there's a lot of different options. Going to have new information on the website about perception, and the book that I'm writing with Dr. Maya Zelahich is on there as well, as far as if you're looking to do an assessment about perception and the process that impacts perception in the workplace, which is key for a lot of companies in this global environment, and the process that you go through. So a lot of information about behavioral help. And in addition, right now, doing a lot of virtual training, a lot of virtual speaking, everything in a unique way, as people are adjusting to the crisis that happened with COVID. And a lot of people like to maybe not necessarily have in-person training or speaking type of situation. So very adaptable there. And all you have to do is contact me through the site, or my email is diane@drdianehamilton.com. You can always reach me there. But just wanted to say, I hope you enjoyed today's episode, and I hope you join us for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio. You've been listening to Take the Lead with Dr. Diane Hamilton on C-Suite Radio.